Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Welcome to the Brooklyn Museum. On behalf of Arnold Lehman, our director here, and Radia Harper, our vice director for education and program development, we are so happy to be hosting this talk between Mickalene Thomas, Carrie Mae Weems, and our curator of contemporary art here, Eugenie Tsai. Is there anybody else who's excited about this? If you haven't seen it yet, I don't know where you guys have been. We're so happy to be welcoming them to talk about how they use their work to challenge conventional ideas of beauty, race, and gender. Now, before I introduce these fabulous artists, I want to point out this pamphlet. Did anyone pick this up? So, I don't know how familiar you guys are with the programming we've done for Mickalene Thomas, but we've done a lot of things, and we have one last program after this program tonight to really talk about her work and what the next step is. So, this is going to be a roundtable, and it's entitled The Black Female Body, and we're going to be exploring such questions as how has a black female body been idealized and misread in visual culture, and how might these tendencies affect black women today? And that's going to be moderated by Deb Willis, who's right here in the front row. So please check that out. That's going to be next Saturday, right here in the same space at 2 p.m. Okay, so now for today. Mickalene Thomas. Ms. Mickalene Thomas was born in Camden, New Jersey. She received a BFA in painting from Pratt Institute and her MFA in painting from Yale University. Working primarily in painting, collage, and photography, her work addresses art history, femininity, and notions of beauty, particularly in relation to African American women. Her work has been collected by many major institutions, including the MoMA, the National Portrait Gallery, right here at the Brooklyn Museum, and many others. And she has been exhibited extensively in both solo and group exhibitions. Her first solo museum exhibition, Origin of the Universe, was organized by the Santa Monica Museum of Art and has been greatly expanded for its presentation here at the Brooklyn Museum. And this is only going to be on view until January 20th, so come back and see it because you don't have much longer, okay? A fully illustrated catalog, the first monograph on Ms. Mickalene Thomas, is available downstairs at the shop. Currently, in addition to the show we have here, her work can also be seen in a solo exhibition at the ICA, the Institute of Contemporary Art in Boston, and that's on view until April 7th. Okay? I know the introduction is a little long, but we want to make sure to give people their due credit and everything like that. Right? Now to Ms. Carrie Mae Weems. Carrie Mae Weems. Carrie Mae Weems, anybody? And an MFA from the University of California, San Diego, and continued her studies in the graduate program in folklore at the University of California, Berkeley. Working across a variety of media, primarily photography and video, her work is invested in storytelling and the ways in which history, art history, community, and identity impact our lived experiences and the stories we tell. Her work is represented in the collections of many major institutions, including the MoMA, the Met, the Whitney, and right here at the Brooklyn Museum, and that's just to name a few locally. And she's been included in more than 150 solo and group exhibitions, both nationally and internationally. Most recently, she has been the subject of a major career retrospective, Carrie Mae Weems, 3 Decades of Photography and Video, and that was organized by the Frist Center for the Visual Arts in Nashville, Tennessee, and it's on view until January 13th of this year. This year and next, the exhibition will travel to Portland, to the Portland Art Museum, the Cleveland Museum of Art, and the Cantor Center for Visual Arts at Stanford. And it will be on view at the Guggenheim from January 24th through April 23rd. So that's not too far away, go check that out. It will be accompanied by a full-color illustrated catalog published by the Yale University Press with essays by leading and emerging scholars. Ms. Carrie Mae Weems has been the recipient of numerous awards and many prizes. Most recently, in November of 2012, she was among five American artists awarded the Medal of Arts by the United States State Department for her contributions to the advancement of art and diplomacy. Can we give her a round of applause? John and Barbara Vogelstein, curator of,
it's long, so that's
okay. 30 more seconds. Eugenie Tsai has been here for 5 years. John and Barbara Vogelstein, curator of the Contemporary Art. She's been on some of our most recently sent for Bigger Sweet Funk. I don't know if you guys saw that, you should have. And the ongoing Raw Cook exhibition, which showcases the work of Under the Radar Brooklyn artists. Here they are, Mickalene Thomas, Carrie Mae Weems, and
I wanted to tell you how this conversation came about. The idea came from remarks made by Mickalene in a 2011 interview in Bomb Magazine. You had just moved to Portland, Oregon in the early 90s, where you were going to school studying pre-law and theater. And you were hanging out with musicians and artists, and you had just started to make art yourself. And then you said, and then I went to see the show of Carrie Mae Weems' photography at the Portland Art Museum, and that was just an incredibly important experience for me in getting started as an artist. So, could you tell us a little bit about seeing the show, that experience, and what it meant to you?
Well, yeah, it was, I believe, 1994 in Portland, Oregon, and I went to the show because actually a friend of mine during that time he's a photographer and he was taking a photo class and said, you have to see this work, it's amazing. And so I went with him to the exhibition and was just inspired and sort of overwhelmed with familiarity of myself. It was the first time seeing images that called to home. I was living in Portland for a number of years, or away from my family, and just these images were so poignant and direct, and they felt like they were telling my story.
Do you want me to show some images?
Yeah, sure. And I think I saw the show probably like five or six times. I kept going back to the show and immediately learned as much as I could about Carrie Mae Weems. She went to school in California and just read some books about who she was and decided that at that time that I was going to make my own art. And went to the art store and got some really cheesy pastels. And
so these are mostly from Ain't Joking and the Kitchen Table series.
Yeah, these are all the ones that I saw that sort of really, one thing that I really responded to is the text with these photographs, because they led to a sort of narrative and story, and they were signifiers to tell you, the viewer, what was happening in the image. And I related to that. And the one that really struck me was the next one, I think, that's here. And so what I did, you can see here, Carrie, I think you're seeing this for the first time. That's actually,
I think we're all seeing it for the first time.
an oil pastel that I did after seeing Carrie Mae Weems' show. And I did these series of works on paper, all based from Carrie's work, and applied to Pratt Institute with them.
You did?
So
how many?
I did about 10 of them, and this is one of the slides that I could find, and remembered seeing this photograph and thinking, I'm going to try to interpret that as I saw it and what it meant. And how I was feeling at that time living in Portland, sort of estranged from my family. There was a lot going on between my relationship with my mother at the time, and just coming to terms with my own sexuality, my identity, and, you know, living in a predominantly white community and dealing with my issues of beauty and relating to that. And so this really spoke to me, and so I wanted to make an image about it. Friend, family friend, and mentor took me to your opening, Rahima Latif. And she introduced me to you at that opening. And I think we exchanged a conversation about how I saw your show and how it, for me, changed my life. And since then, I was thinking about with that, would work, the power of work, how work can sort of, as an artist, why we make art, and how once you have these ideas and notions, and you're a creator in one space as your studio, but then you release it out into the world, and how it can really transform someone. So, you know, you always hear about if someone's sitting in front of a Rothko with that dust to someone, as far as the hue of colors. I sat in front of your photographs, and they were like sitting in front of a Rothko. So for me, it was that poignant and transformative of sort of me deciding to change my career and not pursuing law and becoming an artist.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so. And here I am today, sitting and talking with you.
If it's possible, if it's true that it's possible to have a certain kind of influence on someone like you, who is so absolutely extraordinary.
Not yet.
Then I am completely and deeply, it's beyond flattered. It actually has very little to do with flattery. I think I'm humbled by it. And when I walked into your exhibition this evening, I was humbled by it. I was humbled by the power of the work, by the boldness of the work, by your ability to take this sort of sense of history painting and these ideas about constructing images and bending in a way where you completely claim the essence of yourself and the magic of yourself and the beauty of yourself and the way in which that spills over. I mean, the room was just carried wild. That you should say ashe.
Ashe. This is a, I mean, to sit here is phenomenal.
I'm basking in the glow.
Yeah. And it's a, you know, I have some of my mother's friends here who know the story.
Well, you know, there's a, you know, one of the things that I find so amazing about the work, I'm really thrilled to be here because I think that we have a ton of friends in the audience, people that we've known for years, supporters, friends, fellow artists, people who are making extraordinary things happen, making extraordinary work, who help us with our work, who make what we do possible.
Yeah.
Eugenie, who I've worked with for years, who I've known for years. You, who I've also known for years. So it's really a pleasure to be here.
Yeah.
And I do really take this very humbly, because I think that really the role, that our role in a way is to widen the path, is to make a way for those that are coming behind us. And in part, you know, one of the things that I really love about seeing the show is the role of your mother in the world.
Yes.
And the way in which she takes on a very particular space in the work. And I was hoping that actually you might talk a little bit about the role of your mother in widening this path for you and making this particular kind of work possible.
Yeah, that was a challenge, because that sort of space, to navigate within that space, is very personal. And it's personal, and it's very much a slippery slope, because you will uncover things about a person that you never knew and that you learn and you wish you didn't know. So you open this Pandora box and you can't close it, and so you have to allow it to take its own course. And I think this film was, I don't like to consider it a homage to my mother. I think it's a celebration. It's a celebration of her own trajectory. From my viewpoint, in my perception, as not only a daughter, but a person looking at her life and trying to comprehend who she is as a mother, a black woman, a lover, a divorcee, an abused woman, a drug addict, and looking at her and wanting to know who she is as a human being.
Are you the only child?
No, I act like one, but I do have a little brother. So most people think I am, but
I'd actually like to turn the conversation to you a bit, Carrie. We spoke a couple of weeks ago, and on the phone, I called Carrie and just wanted to chat a bit about this evening, and I said, mistakenly and naively, Mickalene Thomas regards you as a role model.
But I didn't say that.
This was me speaking. And Carrie responded very strongly to the word role model. And I realized now that I will reframe my question to you. I was hoping that you would speak about your role models, how you got started. But now I'm asking if perhaps you would tell us a little bit about influences. The road through the art world is not an easy one, and it necessitates talent and intelligence, which you obviously have, but also sometimes the help of other people and things and events, and I'm just wondering if you could to tell us a little bit about that. I have some images also I could show. I don't know if they relate to inspirational figures and all. I can. That's what we have.
But there is a. I'm influenced every day by something. You know, whether it's
a sound, a texture,
or music, or the last 2 weeks I've been completely absorbed by Rodriguez. I cannot get his music out of my head. And but there is there have been many influences. There have been many, Lauren Simpson was one of my great influences. Mary Lovelace O'Neill was a great influence. Zora Neale Hurston was a great influence. Influences come from many, many different places. In terms of, other artists that I've been really close with, You know, it's
Who was your Carrie Mae Weems?
You know,
who was your Carrie Mae Weems?
I mean, I think that probably I didn't really have one in that way, but there was, I think that Zora Neale Hurston was very important for me as a young artist, who gave me a sort of sense of possibility, a sense of scope and range. And it was probably in some kind of way, really through my encountering Zora and Zora's work, that really helped me sort of tease out something that would become important in terms of the way I would work and think about work and think about art as a metaphor for other states of being, right? You know, that it is that, I believe. You know, as tangible, as real as it is, it's also a construction that is based on, you know, deep imagining, deep imagination. So Zora was very important to me, though other artists have, you know, lingered with me, and different ones do it at different times for other reasons. So, you know, I was looking at Gary Simmons' work this afternoon, really beautiful, those eraser paintings are just fabulous. You know, so there are many people that are on my radar, and but I am interested in you know, this idea of how one refers to the historical, refers to those who have come before, and these ideas about using kind of historical narrative, historical drama, historical painting to make history photographs or history paintings. I think,
like we've done,
very interesting. Yes.
With, that was actually part of it was given to me by Denise Morrell.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so.
I think we have three of your images here. This one? This one?
And this is, that's the series of not, you know, but it's like not Monet's type. It's not Monet's type.
Yeah.
Because,
right.
Yeah.
It's a series of five, actually, and we're looking at three of those. Mm-hmm. And of course, let's look at this microphone. Could you read it for us in your beautiful?
It's Standing on Shaky Ground. I posed myself for a critical study, but was no longer certain of the questions to be asked. It was clear that I was not Monet's type, and Picasso, who had a way with women, only used me, and Duchamp never even considered me. But it could have been worse. Imagine my fate had to Kooning die. So I think that, you know, the thing that,
I love that.
You know, this. So how do you think about using Monet and your
in this, I mean, similar space? In similar space, that, you know, these women aren't Monet's type, or Monet's type, or Courbet's type. Any of the men that I sort of pull from to reclaim a space. So for me, I'm interested in reclaiming that space and transforming it as far as the image of how we see beauty.
So is this in any way an homage to?
No, I don't think it's I think it's. It's a discourse, it's a conversation.
For
me, it's a conversation to have people to create a dialogue with, and when they see images, and hopefully, my goal is that, you know, they will never look at Le Déjeuner the same way after seeing this painting.
Right, I think more than Carrie, though, you seem to, be working, especially in this show, with a very specific body. You know, 19th century iconic white male artists, Monet, Courbet, Manet. And it does raise the question of what is your enterprise? It's a conversation, but is it a friendly conversation? Is it an attempt to revise the canon? Is it, it doesn't have to be one or the other, but
I don't think it can be one or the other. I think to say that it is one versus the other is to sort of close down the conversation, because it's very open, and I think just like beauty itself is very complex. You know, we live in a very complex world where we, you know, the idea of beauty provides, you know, perceptual, you know, pleasure and satisfaction. What does that mean? You know, what is providing perceptual pleasure and satisfaction and images? And so for me, I'm taking these sort of iconic images and sort of reclaiming the space of how you would sort of see black women and beauty. Because in history, even though they had sort of their sort of moment, like Le Déjeuner, when it was created, that was a particular space for Manet. And reading it in art history now, it's a new sort of idea to really think about what that painting means today. And to remake that painting as these three black women in the window of MoMA is to sort of transform the idea of these iconic images.
What about you, Carrie? What was your impetus to making this particular series?
Well, I mean, it's, you know, this is really sort of interesting because I think that, you know, I mean, I'm not sure, like, if we can, you know, like, in a sort of sense of sort of history painting, like, you know, reclaim them as such, because in a way, they're not really, quote, ours to claim.
No,
it simply is what it is. But I think that the part that I think is critical and really most interesting is that there is a way in which you can have that you can begin to create alongside of that space something that is equally dynamic,
absolutely,
something equally powerful, equally charged, and in a way in which you don't normally see black women positioned. And so for me, what the work has a lot to do with, the work that motivates me, the thing that gets me up every morning, as I was telling my girlfriend Deb Willis this morning, was how do you negotiate this space where blackness and black women are not to be seen?
Yeah.
How do you do that? Yeah. How do you do that? Right? And that every morning I get up and I know that I have to deal with being an invisible being.
Yeah.
In my presence, I still have to
and
deal
to do that
with this
invisible
which is
a piece
of so space. You can create these spaces.
Yes.
And that becomes then the challenge of your everyday.
Yeah.
Is how do you assert that we have a right to be here? And not only do we have a right to be here, but our beauty is here and it's being simply denied. But we are struggling to
yes.
say, no, I won't allow you to strip me of my humanness. I won't allow you to strip me. And so, when you seriously, when I encountered this work, I said, this sister has claimed this space.
Yeah.
Not reclaimed it, but claimed it, took it.
Yeah.
It's purposeful and it has really deep meaning, and so, you know, and I think that there's something really interesting and dynamic that's going on, because I'm sort of thinking about these sort of same things in the same sort of way, and also thinking about the way in which that I had to come to grips with the fact that, no, I am not Manet's guy.
Yeah, right.
I'm not. And that he didn't create any of this shit for me.
Yeah.
My responsibility then to myself as an artist is to make it for me, is to make the space for me. And it becomes the most difficult thing that we do, but the truest thing and the most honest thing that I think that we do with our work.
So it seems to be simultaneously critique and active resistance and celebration.
I mean, celebration is a strange word, but I understand what you mean. So I'll
I think
say
celebration in that sense is a strange word to Manet.
It's more about just trying to get close to the bone of being real, and that it's not so much a celebration,
yeah.
but rather
right.
a claiming of possibility and the breadth of possibility. Because I think the way in which we are often looked at is through such a narrow band, such a small sliver of scope, that it becomes really impossible for the width and the breadth of the depth of you to really be seen and understood. And so that, I think, is the thing that gets me really excited about seeing the work that I'm seeing contemporarily by people like Mickalene and Hank Willis Thomas and other people that are working contemporarily, Gary Simmons. I mean, they really charge me with a great sense of possibility. It's really quite wonderful.
So in the future editions of the Art History, the Gardner Art History Survey, we will have Manet, Carrie Mae, and Mickalene together.
Sounds like a nice show.
Yeah, in,
you guys special.
Absolutely, in these parallel universes is the wrong word, but running side by side these.
Well, I mean, you know, there is a wonderful discourse that's going on. And I think that, you know, one of the things that happens when you allow for multiple voices is you allow for multiple possibilities. And I think, again, you start to get closer to the possibility of what is true.
What is more true. Well, that's why we make up, that's why I've chosen to be an artist.
Yeah.
Is to get closer to what is true to myself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, making art is an extension of yourself. You know, and you can only put what's true of yourself out there and to make it truly authentic.
You know, I really love these little rooms upstairs.
Oh, my tutors there.
Yeah. But you're both so interested in interiors, and you use interiors as these, and often domestic interiors, as I think almost a stage set for creating a narrative. And I was fascinated by that overlap in your work, as well as your interest in family or creating a sense of family and creating a sense of a narrative, of a drama within the confines of these small rooms. Can you talk about your
my rooms?
Well, you're both drawn to the interiors and an interesting and similar but slightly different way. Similar but slightly different way, I think. Perhaps perhaps the same, but you know your domestic interiors as a setting for your photo shoots and your actual creation of rooms. But so many things happen or have the potential to happen within your rooms, within your interiors, and everything in the rooms seems to be so deliberately chosen, and you know the people arranged, set up.
I thought about this for a few years about the way in which women often work in interior spaces. That a lot of women work in interior spaces, and a lot of women work alone in interior spaces, and they create sort of spaces of domesticity. Often, I mean, many women artists have done this. Women painters, photographers, etc. So it's sort of, I think that there's something about really the sort of ongoing examination of the place that we are the most familiar with. It has to do with a kind of a deconstruction and a problematizing and looking at and analyzing of the home space, which is the space that women are for the most part confined to and use, right, to decorate, to play out, to fantasize around, etc., etc. So I think that, there was a wonderful, wonderful exhibition, actually, I think maybe at the Whitney a few years ago, maybe 10 years ago, called Dirt and Domesticity. It was, also looking at, sort of like the deconstruction of family space, household space. So I think that, for me, it also comes out of this, and also out of a way of like looking very privately, very privately and very much alone. And for the most part, I use my own, sort of rickety cameras, and I photograph in my living room and in my kitchen, and I did that for a long time. I haven't actually in a number of years, but I used to work that way very much.
About you, Mickalene, and the interior.
I think the interior is definitely relates to,
you know, being a woman and domesticity and sort of like that, those sort of confined spaces. But for me, it's that way of, you know, really understanding like nostalgia and memory and really thinking about the women that have come before me and created these spaces and how they created these spaces and the layered history that is within those spaces that have come before me. You know, I'm really interested in sort of the fabrication of the space and how they're made and how they become sort of these artifice for signifiers of memory and storytelling and narrative and just perception of time and how we are, who we are, become an individual through pictures, through fabrication of the materials. And I say that because, you know, my grandmother used to upholster her furniture. And sort of those ways of how you decide to decorate a space in sort of these formulas.
The wood paneling is always mentioned in terms of...
Well, the wood paneling, because, you know, when you think about sort of these fabricated spaces that I work out of from the late 50s, 60s, so sort of when, you know, new materials have been introduced into, you know, construction.
Wood vinyl.
Yeah, wood vinyl, and how, you know, it was this idea of masking and layering or covering up a sort of wall, and once you pull away that wall, there may be some wallpaper behind it, or, you know, paint and layers of wallpaper, which is this history of time, of stories, of people who've lived there before. So I'm interested in that. And the spaces upstairs were all spaces, narrative spaces that were telling a story from the different models that I worked with. How I felt about them, leaving just sort of signifiers of pictures or a dress that they wore during the photo shoots, or a wig that I used for the photo shoot, because my spaces are these faux spaces that are just put together for the photographs, you know, and they're not real, but they're meant to be looked at as real when you look at the images.
They're
also tableaus, just thinking about, you know, theater and props and how we sort of think of performances and creating.
It's your background in theater.
It's about really capturing a particular time that I remember in growing up in space, whether it was my grandmother's home or my mother's space.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're beautifully articulated spaces. They really are. There was a woman walking past me. She was looking at like the cigarette in the ashtray, and she said, "That is so serious." You know, it reminded me of I was listening a couple of days ago to this really wonderful, wonderful interview with Wynton Marsalis, and he's playing music all around the world, and. They were asking him about, you know, playing in different cultures. And he said, you know, I can always get the understructure. I can always get the understructure. But learning the melody, learning the melodic line is much more complicated because that's where the culture is. You know? And so when she saw that cigarette in the ashtray, right? And she said,
well, yeah, because right, you mean it's that residue. It's sort of the residue of time and space that someone was there. You know, it's the grease on the wall.
It's
the footprint that I'm interested in that leads you from one moment to the next. That tells a whole different story. And so I'm interested in sort of those clues and connections when you look at the space, that every aspect in a room is contained by someone who was there, the record playing in the background, or just, you know, a book that was opening. because it's, I'm not interested in sort of having the spaces be as if they were going to be in a window or a window display. Because I want the viewer to feel that they've resided in the space, or that they can.
Their work.
Yeah.
Their work. It has a beautiful resonance. It really, really does. It's very, very, very powerful. You know, I was just, there's only one other thing that I wanted to ask you about. Because both of us are having major retrospectives right now, major exhibitions right now. I'm doing one that's traveling around at the moment. It closes next year.
But it opens at the Guggenheim next year.
Yeah, next year, this time, so hopefully we'll see many of you there. But working on it was, I think, you know, I spent like the last 3 years of my life working on this exhibition. It's worn me out. It's worn me out. So I wanted to ask about this exhibition and how this exhibition shapes.
It's very political.
This exhibition took shape and how you're feeling about it, how you feel about what's here and what it means to you to have this exhibition at this point in your career.
I think it's it was very important for me to have it, and I think you know I just want to back up a little because when I was invited to do the show, the idea was to use works that were loaned from collectors. I think we talked about that. It was a traveling show, but how this show came about was initially we were going to do two separate shows. One at the Brooklyn Museum and then one at Santa Monica. And then we decided to...
The Brooklyn Museum decided to take a show organized by Santa Monica, which consisted of 16 works. But because Mickalene is our hometown girl and a very important artist, we decided that we would enlarge the show greatly. And we did borrow about 50 collages, and those were in
collections. Yeah,
and then, of course, you made the four installations and four paintings, and, you know, a lot of work, a lot of new work, the film about your mother for the exhibition. And the focus, as it was at Santa Monica's, of art of the past couple of years. But it really allowed us, I think, a window into your process. And the way that you meet.
Yeah, but for me, I don't think of this show as a retrospective or survey. I think it.
Can we call it an overview? A sampling?
Well, because I think, you know, I still consider myself a very young artist. You know, my career is, I maybe just above emerging artists, but you know, haven't really been exhibiting that long, so I think this is a great opportunity to have, and I haven't had that many museum shows. So for me, it was really important when I did both of these shows, Santa Monica and Brooklyn Museum, that they were going to be new works to challenge myself, my own practice, and what I was thinking about at the time. And I didn't feel like, as the artist that I am, that it was fair to myself to just put work out there that people had already seen. I wanted to sort of push my own boundaries in what I was making in my studio.
And
show some different aspects of what I'm working on. Because, you know, so many people at the time were just used to a particular body of work, which were the portraits of most of the women, where a lot of the landscape paintings were not shown, and a lot of the interior paintings weren't shown. And my studio practice consists of not just painting, but also the installations and photography that the viewer doesn't usually get to see when they go to an exhibition. So it was really important to show the full scope of who I am and what I do as an artist.
One thing I did notice, an interesting coincidence in both of your work, is where you were doing the kitchen table series, Carrie, and your next series moved out into the world, the Sea Island series and the Africa project.
Okay.
And you too were
landscapes,
working largely in interiors, and then one of the new directions you took and one of the new genres you decided to explore was landscape. I was curious about that and wondering if you would comment on that?
Oh, I think for me it has a lot to do with, like, you know, running around the world. You know, like,
so you're tired of being at home?
I love being outside. I mean, but I mean, you know, really, it does have a lot to do with, you know, what I'm interested in. And, you know, I've been thinking about architecture for a really, really long time. And so it was important to do that work. And, you know, like, work happens because you're in a certain space, a certain frame, certain things that you need to work at. Kitchen table, which was a wonderful piece to work on, and I worked on it, like, you know, every day for months and months and months until it was done, and then it was done, and then it was time to, I mean, move on. And so for a long time, I've actually been outside. I've been outdoors and trying to figure out ways to be outdoors and trying to figure out what my real interests are in architecture. You know, so on the one hand, I'm really interested in, you know, colonial architecture. I'm interested in the architecture of slavery. I'm interested in, in the material culture, the way in which, you know, Southern material culture has articulated itself in its own particular expressive utterance. And so, you know, so the Sea Island series came about, you know, the architecture of slavery, the architecture of the sexualization of space has been something that I've been interested in too for a really long time. And so worked in that area, trying to understand that. And then, of course, power of architecture, and architecture as power has been, you know, endlessly interesting as well. So those things sort of keep me kind of moving around. You know, kind of keep me moving around and moving through space in a very particular kind of way. And now, you know, recently I've been doing a lot of work in Rome and photographing museums, photographing myself standing in front of things. That's what I do now, just run around and stand in front of stuff. And you know, museums and thinking about what museums are and how museums function. So I've just been doing that actually for a really, really long time. I really haven't made, like, any
interior
stuff.
The interior is kind of an exception in your work. The interior was an exception in your work, as opposed to, although
which
not many
is
type. Oh, the kitchen table series, also not many is type, which is another
kind
of studio.
Yeah, and you know, and interestingly enough, I have to tell you this. Interestingly enough, Nominee's Type came about because I was working with Robert Colescott. Robert Colescott, the painter, asked me to photograph him for the Venice Biennale when he was representing the United States. So he called me and he asked me if I would like to make his portrait. And I said, that's an interesting request. He's calling my black ass to photograph him. He must have something else in mind. And so, you know, so I flew out to see him, and I made these photographs. It was very funny. It's a great story, actually, photographing Robert Colescott in his house. But I started thinking about painting. I started thinking a lot about painting, photographing Robert Colescott in his painting studio. And so it was really actually through going back to this earlier question, this first question about an essay on influences, it was really in photographing Robert Colescott in his painting studio that I really started thinking about painting. And then I started thinking about him more, I started looking at paintings more, I started looking at sort of the people that he'd been influenced by more, you know, and then that led me ultimately, I think, to Manet. And then that led me to doing not Manet's Type, actually. And so it was really interesting. I mean, that sort of journey, right? You know, that again, you sort of work on things when you really need to work on them because you're moved by something, where you're introduced to an idea or a concept that you know you can swing the door open just a little further if you go down that path. And so it's been really wonderful working alongside that and thinking about what other artists do, because other artists and their imagination help me to come to grips with my own. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I can't read the New York Times on Sunday without getting up and going to my studio. I can't read it passively. You know, like, I'm too, have to go work. You know, it's like, if these people are working, then I need to be downstairs in my studio.
But I think it's just listening to you talk about how Robert Cole, thinking about Robert Colescott, and how you were thinking about painting, and then really looking at who he was influenced by leading into Manet. I think that's what led me to Manet myself by looking at Romeo Bearden and Matisse.
Okay.
You know, by looking at those artists and really sort of looking at their influences and seeing who they were looking at.
Right.
And I think it's, as an artist, it's important to do that. I think it's important not to just stop at, if you're interested in a contemporary artist, not to stop at that artist, but to look at who they're really influenced. Because it tells a deeper story of where the work is coming from and what it really is about.
Right. And also, you know, there's this sort of really beautiful span of play.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, again, when I think about the canvases that I've just seen upstairs, I love these references to, you know, to Matisse, you know, but also the thing that excites me most is not only the play with Matisse or the play with Manet or the play with Bearden, but it's you're bending those notes yet again back into something that is really totally, absolutely your own. And so it's like being completely aware of history, completely aware of the historical context in which you come out of, and that you have this sort of really wonderful sort of kiss to, and yet making it completely your own simultaneously.
Yeah.
It really is your work with a nod in that direction.
Well, yeah, taking the best of their work, I think, mm-hmm. and playing around with it blindfolded and saying, this is what I'm going to come up with.
Yeah.
I think that's important. And looking at artists and why you're looking at them to sort of make work that's your own.
Yes.
Because I think, you know, thinking about what does a painter make in 2012? How does a painter sort of look at history and decide that they're going to paint in a particular way?
Yes.
You know, why should we make that decision to say that I'm going to sort of, you know, be this abstract painter or conceptualist and sort of our abstract expressionist or a figurative painter? Like, I think it's really important to look at art and pull from it.
So categories are irrelevant.
I think so.
It's good.
Mm-hmm. I think so.
Yeah, I mean, this question of, you know, what is painting? What does it matter? Doesn't matter.
So you're known as a photographer, but you're a photographer who uses text and makes installation, and you're a painter who has a hybrid practice that includes collage and painting and film, and you are both filmmakers and have been known.
Well, I wouldn't call myself a filmmaker yet.
You're
so an
excellent filmmaker. And I was curious about that.
I love working.
And we both worked with a fantastic person.
You do.
You know, working with Tanya, I think she's.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Tanya's here. We love Tanya. Tanya is always helping us with our work. She's great, and she's a fabulous actress.
Oh, she is.
And, yeah, I mean, you know, but
sorry to interrupt, I actually started working with Tanya on my film. Because I knew she was working with you. When Tanya sent the email out to everyone, she had a list of artists that she was working with at a particular time. And I saw that she was working with Carrie Mae Weems, and I said, that's great.
Yeah.
I love working on film. I started a long, long time ago. You know, they don't really get shown very much, but because I don't do enough about that, you know. And, you know, and we'll see what happens. I mean, I just, you know, at this point, I think that you should do whatever makes you happy.
Exactly.
You know, and if it's, you know, making paintings, little drawings, or little photographs, or big photographs, or, you know, I'm just trying to figure out a way through through my life and really trying to understand what the journey is and how to make important work on the journey that is meaningful to myself first and foremost, but certainly to the people that I love and that I care about as well, that has a depth and a breadth to it, that asks tough questions of itself and of its audience and of me. And trying to figure out a way that that I can make a space for myself and for Black people that is rich and powerful and whole. And if I can do that in photographs or in text or in films or if I have to tap dance myself, I'm just...
I think we would all agree that you have done a magnificent job succeeding all of those fronts.
No, I was just going to say, you know, film for me, it's just really... wanting to experiment with another medium, and I think it's important to just, you know, have fun with whatever comes to mind and find the best medium to execute your ideas, you know, and just do it.
And I love telling people what to do.
Yeah. You do. What would you tell me to do?
No, I love the community of filmmaking, you know, because I work so much on my own in such a my little room with my little stuff and my little
time. So you feel you like directing?
Yeah, I enjoy directing and I love bringing people together in a certain kind of way to make something happen. And so it's in film and in video that I actually get a chance to stretch out in a way. And I love working with composers. So I work a lot with composers as well, who usually do my music for me, and it allows me to use voice in a very particular kind of way that I don't ordinarily get a chance to use it as well. So those are the things that I really like about making film. And, you know, every time I finish making one, I said, well, I'm not going to do another one because it's too difficult, but invariably I go back to it, and I'm happy about that. Maybe we'll do one together.
That would be great. Very small experience with filmmaking is the editing process, because you know, just learning about the editing process is sort of that collaging of images of really taking sort of the smallest filmic seconds and making it into a story.
So do you edit yourself?
I actually, in this film, I edited with a fantastic editor team, Alex and Tanya, so I learned a lot about it. But I finally got my own Final Cut Pro and will be editing my
videos. Yeah, no, I love editing. That's like the fun part. And that putting it together, that structure, you know, because the structure is so...
Yeah, it's so, you know, for me, that's, I think, where the magic happens.
Absolutely.
You know, it's like the painting part.
That's right.
And so working with the editor on this film, it was like sitting there with him, was like, you know, that sort of dialogue of like, no, this, that. I think editing for me, I think, is one of the parts that I would enjoy. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you so much, both of you.
Statement about how we're meant to survive, but also your sense of possibility. And I guess absent the kind of fracturing that Mickalene does in her work upstairs, it's incredibly stunning, and how you write and interrupt a certain kind of master narrative. Separate from the Manet engagement, all the kind of European masters, I'm wondering quite directly and deliberately how you understand Black female figuration, racial figuration, in the contemporary moment. Could you talk a bit more about that accent? The kind of specter of the great masters.
It's the acoustics are here are kind of are bad. So if you could perhaps short and a
what I'm asking basically is that it's a more direct question about how you guys produce your work outside the conversation with the great masters. How you understand
Black female figuration.
In particular as being, you know, some of the most least protected folks on the planet. And how do you understand, separate from the conversation with the masters that's been dominating the conversation this evening, Black female figuration in your art contemporaneously in the current moment?
So I thought that that he actually spoke to that.
Yeah. Okay. No, he didn't. No, you didn't. I guess what I was thinking about is a sense of possibility and internal possibility, self-generated possibility, which is you've spoken about too. But I'm asking, I guess, a very local, deliberate question about Black female figuration that has no, is not so preoccupied by the masters themselves, you know? Like, some more of that. You have spoken about that so much, but I wanted some of that conversation to be separate from the master narrative so much.
Well, for me, I think that, I'm just trying to understand all of it, but it's kind of just a little muffled from this end. For me, thinking about a contemporary Black female figuration, I was actually really interested in a new type of Black female body that's a little more masculine, and what that means in the idea of femininity and masculinity, of sort of androgyny. So that's something I want to explore in my work, as far as if you're thinking of a contemporary Black figuration. I guess to put it in that terms is, you know, I'm a Black woman and I paint Black women. As simple as that. So I guess those categories become a little, they become a little boxed for me. Because I think there is sort of, you know, white figuration and Asian figuration, Black figuration. What does that really mean on the Black body? And I think there's for me a new type of Black figuration, which is female masculinity.
So that's another topic. Hey.
Hi, I'm so happy to be here. Worked really hard to get in here. My name is Imari, I'm a photographer, and I specifically want to ask you, what were your viewpoints in terms of media influence on Black women and their ideals of beauty? Because that's an area that I'm exploring also in terms of filming interviews and speaking to other women artists.
Yeah. What's the, I just heard ideal of beauty.
In terms of media influences, because through your art you're exploring the female figure, and you mentioned, you know, the different influences in terms of different body types and how you portray, and specifically you also look at Black women. So what I want to know is, what is your viewpoint in terms of what pushes ideas of beauty for us as Black women, do you think? Do you think it's media, is media based strongly, or is it culturally, or what develops, what directs that?
For me, I think, because
of you. Because you both work in different media formats.
Yeah. I think for me, it's the models that I work with. That draws the notions of sort of their beauties, what I'm interested in.
But you also select the models.
Sometimes. I think I think for me, I see it more of an element of myself in them, and I see myself portrayed in them. And I want to sort of emulate that sense of who they are in portraiture. Sort of the desire of their beauty, and sort of capture that. I think it's this notion of, you know, the perceived seduction that I'm interested in. Of how one walks into a room sort of
it enters a space. I'm interested in beauty in that level, of a sense of beauty as power, I think. And I think that's why I have a new fascination with female masculinity right now. Of really understanding that.
You know, I was just thinking about, and again, Deb Bullitt's here, and has just been, her exhibition on beauty has been moving around the country for the last couple of years, and did a conference on beauty, I don't know, maybe a year ago, I think.
Oh, the Pose of Beauty.
And in doing another exhibition, or rather, a conversation that's going to take place in Paris this month. Right, that really sort of targets this and looks at this, I think, you know, critically. You know, this word, I think the word itself in a way is so kind of loaded, isn't it?
Yeah.
It sort of sends us, in, you know, onto, you know, platforms that are kind of shaky, you know, but there is something about, I think, the way in which I sort of process this is that there's something about the beautiful, and there's something about misplaced desire and wholeness, and that for me, the thing that is cracked, the thing that is broken within our culture is a refusal to see the wholeness of brown people. And so to the extent that we refuse to see the wholeness of ourselves is the extent to which we are also then made not, quote, beautiful, but made ugly and unsightly, right? Which is why then the media doesn't really carry us very far. Which is why we don't really exist anywhere outside of the work that, for the most part, black women make. You know, it's a really complicated, complicated problem. It's beyond the question of beauty to really the way in which this thing, this diseased mind, has really corrupted our surface. And that then becomes our challenge, how to make us whole, how to make us complex creatures,
yeah.
Because we are complex, and therefore how to reveal that. And the other thing that I want to say about this, for me this is, I think, a very, very important thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I am turning 60 soon, and I'm so excited. About women turning 60. But it occurred to me a few years ago that, for the most part, black women deal with black women, and that very few people are interested really in dealing with black women. And I was talking with Deb this morning about this horrible thing where this dynamite young director has come along, and she's made a film called In the Middle of Nowhere. It's sort of really wonderful thing about this, right? And it opens, and it makes $2. It makes $2. And before, you know, it's been, you know, given, you know, at Sundance, like best director, and best actor, and best film, and best. You know what I mean? Just goes on, you know, and yet it opens and it closes before it opens, and it generates $2, right? And so a part of the sort of difficulty then of being a woman and being an artist and being a woman who is interested in brown bodies and presenting those bodies in their complexity, which is, I believe, what we're doing, means that we are also distanced from something. So this brother mentioned this question about the masters, and playing with the masters, and tap dancing around the masters, and having on the one hand to sort of pay respect to them even as we forge new territory for ourselves. And for me, it's a much more dynamic question because it really has to do with how do you situate yourself within the discourse of modernism itself, within the discourse of contemporary art, even as a black woman, and even as you negotiate the black body and black subjects. So, because for the most part, to the extent that you present the blackness, is to the extent that you're pushed out of the field and out of the range of being considered a contemporary artist, which is really bizarre, but absolutely true, right? That you can't be a modern, contemporary, forward-thinking artist and make pictures of black people. And that's your contemporary too.
You know?
You can't
So this becomes like a sort of an interesting, it's a really interesting question. I hope that you understand what I'm saying. You know, to the extent that you are pushed into this box, this racialized box, is to the extent that you're not considered a serious player in the field of contemporary art. And then your blackness then sets you into another category altogether. And so you're constantly fighting against that push to push you out and to make you a part of another kind of tradition. Not of a, you know, contemporary painting, contemporary photography, but, you know, that black stuff over there. You know, it's still relegated in a very curious way.
But what's your take?
I look at the two of you and I see two incredibly successful contemporary artists.
Well, you're a brown woman.
Oh, you don't think so.
But that makes it even more relevant, doesn't it?
I mean, you know, I did an interview with somebody the other day, and I said to him, I said, you know, there's so many things to talk about. I think that maybe we might be able to talk about something other than race. When you view this work, is there something else that we can talk about other than race? Right? And so he said, yeah, you know? So I get the review back, and that's what it is. That's what it is. That's what it is. And so there's this way in which the work is often reduced, right? It's reduced in all kinds of ways, which is one of the reasons that I was asking Mickalene about the way in which this exhibition came about. Because I think that it raises some really interesting questions. So this may not be your case. I trust it isn't, you know, and I wouldn't want it to be, but I do know that this is real, that this thing that we are fighting against, that we are challenged, is with this idea of what black artists mean and what black women artists mean and how they are perceived in the larger world in a general sense.
I don't think I went to art school to make black art. I just went to art school to make art. You know, to learn about making art. And I think, you know, I don't really per se like to be put in boxes of one way or, you know, it's the whole idea of, you know, saying that I make queer art or something like that. It's, for me, it's you know, my hope is just for people to look at the work and respond to it, and it has all of these different layers. It has all of that because it's an extension of who I am. You know, it is black art, it is queer art, it is
right.
Contemporary
and
art.
Contemporary art, it, all of those things, I...
Oh, yes, I think so.
Yeah.
Oh, do you think that I was saying that it wasn't?
I was beginning to wonder if you were saying that it
was. No, she wasn't.
Yeah.
You completely misunderstand it, though. I'm really talking about the way I think in which the work is generally positioned in the larger world, and how it's discussed in the larger world, how it's reviewed, how it's written about endlessly in the larger world. It is distanced from modernism.
right?
Yes.
Because
something important. Yes, indeed.
That's what I mean. Yeah. That's what I mean. And so then therein lies the challenge then, to be current and contemporary and part of the moment, but to bring this discourse into that arena in an acceptable way.
I see three people who've been standing here very patiently, and I'm ask your question.
Hey, we should go. We should have martinis.
For one more, so for the other two.
Which one?
She's famous dead.
We're gonna start with a quick one.
Do either of you teach?
Yes.
Okay, and the second question is how important was education, undergrad, grad school, post-grad, how important was that for you, either artist, navigating your style and the subject matter in which you were going to work? How important was education for you, finding your artistic voice?
Major. Absolutely essential. I mean, I think it's so important. It's really great to be with your peers and your friends and your colleagues and to fight and to argue and to bicker and to go to class and to, you know, have your work dismissed. Yeah. Makes you strong.
Last question.
Hi, my name is Gabriel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I really liked what you both had to say about space in terms of your art, and it's something I've been thinking about for a while. And just could you speak to really quickly, I don't really have a question about space, it's just like it really identified with me today. And I was wondering if you could just talk about centering in terms of your artistic processes, and when you know you're just like, you know, you're rolling over and over and you're not getting anywhere with your ideas. And if you just have so, like for me as an artist, I'm really trying not to confine myself to painter or this or that, but just it's a space where I can pull from all of these different mediums. And I really see that in both of you. And, could you just talk? Because
I think that the work tells you what it needs to be.
Yeah.
Work really tells you what it needs to be. And the best thing that, you know, the best advice I can give anyone is to go to your studio and to work every day.
That's what I tell my friends and my students. That your work will tell you where it needs to go, and it won't lie to you. It will beat you up when you're not nice. And you don't go to the studio, you know, so it's
Thank you, that's just what I wanted to hear.
One more question?
So my name is Francesca, and I just got up as soon as we started discussing, or I guess coming into, you know, an African-American woman, an Asian woman, and myself as a Latin American woman, where we have pretty much the same struggles with identity, with so many things. But I guess that will be too long right now to discuss. However, we were passed around some papers where there were three questions asked. And there were, we were supposed to post in or text our thoughts about them. So the three questions were, what is a woman? What is security? And what is not art? So I was wondering, probably the last one, to me, it's probably very interesting because we have discussed women in general. As artists, what is not art for you?
What is not art?
What is not art? What is your take on that question?
I guess the question.
Maybe we should ask one of the assistant deans of Yale University what is not art.
Is it something very subjective to you still? Or is it recognizable? Everywhere you see it?
But you know, I suppose you could be, you know, like, it's, you know, at first I thought, do I really need to answer this question? But, you know, like just voices, you know, everything is art and everything can, and everyone can be an artist. And, you know, we can take that into deeper places. But I think that everybody does have that possibility. And I think that, you know, as I move over the course of my day, through the course of my day, I'm, you know, the pistons are just firing. What I'm looking at and what I'm seeing, what's happening around me is always inspiring and dynamic and artistic and filled with infinite possibility. And for me, the thing is trying to contain my excitement. Mm.